Good morning, Lincoln Glenn. So glad that you are joining us today. I want to introduce you or reintroduce you to Evelyn. You may recognize her. Evelyn led maybe 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, one time for us on a Sunday morning. And she is here to help us out for at least a few weeks as Joseph is back running the camera right now back there and helping us out back with the tech stuff. So Evelyn's going to be here. So I'm going to pray and we're going to start our service. Lord, thank you so much for Evelyn coming here and leading us in worship. And thank you that we are entering into this season where we celebrate the birth of Jesus. And in the midst of everything going on, I pray that we can focus on you and glorify you, and that we can find our hope not in our circumstances, but in you, because you do not change. Yeah. So we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, well, good morning, everyone. Let's sing, O Come, All Ye Faithful.
O come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Oh, sing, all ye bright ones of heaven above. Glory to God, all glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, him, Christ the Lord.
Yea, Lord, we greet thee.
Yea, Lord, we greet thee. Born this happy morning, Jesus, to thee be our glory give. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. I will trust in you alone. joy, unending joy. And I will follow where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow.
Where you go,
where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
It's a special time in our worship service this week as we light the first Advent candle. Typically, through the traditions, people have different thoughts about what this symbolizes, but most are anticipating the joy of celebrating Christmas, remembering the first coming of Jesus. We celebrate that also, but we also look forward to the second coming of Jesus, which is our blessed hope. But listen to these words from the prophet Isaiah that Debbie's going to read that talk about the longing, the desire, the anticipation of waiting for the Messiah to come the first time.
The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Joy to the world, the Lord has come.
For many years, Lincoln Glen Church has said thank you and Merry Christmas to our pastors and staff in a very wonderful way. And I want to encourage you to be a part of that if that's something you'd like to do, and that's to give a Christmas gift to our pastors and our staff. It's something that we will collect and we will distribute. It's blessed pastors for many, many years at Lincoln Glen Church. And I'd encourage you to want to be a part of that. It's very simple. You can just include it in your gift that you're giving now, and then put pastor's gift or staff gift, and then we will make sure that it goes to the appropriate individuals. I just want to thank you for your participation. Merry Christmas.
We want to thank you again for joining us today online here at Lincoln Glen Church. We want to share with you some exciting things that are going on. First of all, on our website, you might notice there's a whole new Bible reading plan. We're so excited that so many of us are getting in deeper and deeper into God's Word, letting Him speak to us, change us. So that's on our website. Please take a look at that and try to keep up with the reading that's there.
Yeah, or you can go to our Instagram, our Facebook page. You can find it there as well. Also, Christmas Eve is coming up. Obviously, this Christmas season is going to be very different. Like we said, we're going to miss gathering together as a large group in our sanctuary. But we are still gonna gather and have a great celebration. It's just gonna be online. And so even though this is different, we're still planning a special service, and we want all of you to come join us. Anytime on Christmas Eve, you can come to our website, lincolnglen.org, and you can find our service. You can watch it anytime in your pajamas, in fancy clothes, anything like that, anything that you got. But also, please bring someone with you, not physically, but invite someone with you. This is the time of year where people are really open to an invite to come to church. So bring someone with you, invite them with you to join us.
I'm really excited about it. You can wear just anything you want. I even have some sports jerseys I could put on.
I knew this was coming. Can we cut that part out of the service?
Okay. Well, hey, we want to share something else with you guys. We've been talking the last several weeks about this offering that we take, the tin cup offering, we call it. And this year we were designating it for City Team Ministries right here in our city. And I'm very happy to tell you that as of, I guess,
yesterday or today, we have about $1,700 that has come in. That's going to go straight to City Team, and we're so grateful for your generosity, and thank you for that. And right now would be a wonderful time to take our offering. You'll see on the screen all the places how you can give with PayPal or our online giving, all these things. Just thank you so much, especially now in our Christmas time, our holiday season. Also want to mention that this is the time, if you'd like to designate something for the deacon offering, we are pretty active in meeting needs of individuals in our church family and in our community. So let's go to prayer right now. Lord, we thank you for how you've blessed us, how this season gives us hope and joy. And Lord, I pray that we will be willing to give of ourselves and also of our finances to bless others, to be a light in this world, and to show that you are the light that have come in to give us hope and love. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for everyone who's listening. We pray your blessing on them. And this offering, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All
right. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save us sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered would soon deliver you. Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleep see. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Verse 3. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great.
I don't know if you've ever had this where you thought you were doing something right, and then you looked at someone else who was doing it and you realized, oh, that's how you do it? Like, I'm totally wrong. No one has ever accused me of being handy with tools or anything like that. No one's ever accused me of that. When my wife and I got married, she would make fun of me because she said that probably 99% of the tools that we have in our family came from my wife before we got married. And she jokes that I brought like a pink IKEA toolbox to our marriage. And she's wrong. It was an orange IKEA toolbox that I brought to our marriage. And that's all that. I'm not handy. I'm not at all. So actually, my wife and I met on a Mexico mission trip where we're building houses. And I remember there would be times where I would be doing something handy and thinking that I'm doing it right, and then I look at somebody else and realize, oh my gosh, I've been doing this wrong the whole time. I'm not doing this right at all. Sometimes when you look at somebody else, you notice that is how you actually do it. I've been doing it wrong the whole time. It can be a humbling experience, but it's a good thing to realize if I've been doing it wrong, it's good for me to know so I can learn how to do it right. When we look to Jesus, that so often happens to us, that we might think that we're doing something right, but then when we look to Jesus, we realize, wow, I have been doing it wrong the whole time. Because Jesus takes things that we think we're living out, and he takes them 10 steps further. Jesus takes things that we think we understand, and he takes them even deeper. Jesus has this ability to take what we think we are doing well with and say, no, there is so much more depth to it than we realized. And so we're going to look at that this morning. We're going to look at a story found in Mark chapter 10, verse 35. And so if you want to flip in your own Bible, it'll be on the screen in just a minute. But we're going to look at that. We've been leading up this Christmas season talking about how it is more blessed to give than to receive. And last week we looked at Acts 20, 35. So remembering the words the Lord Jesus himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. When we look at Jesus, we realize that we get the idea of giving all wrong, that we get the idea of receiving all wrong, we get the idea of serving all wrong. And as we talk about giving, let me say again that we're looking at a holistic approach to this. We're not just looking at giving financially, we're not just looking at giving in terms of any specific way, but in a holistic way, that giving involves our time, our treasures, our talents, our spiritual gifts. The resources we have. It does include our finances, but we're looking at such a more a wider range than just our finances. And so don't, when you hear giving, don't just hear financial. Hear about your whole life and how you can give and what you have to give. And so that's what we're looking at this morning, how Jesus takes the idea of giving, whether it might be our time or whatever it might be, and he takes it so much further than we think. And so listen to Mark chapter 10, verse 35. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. They replied, let one of us sit at your right hand and the other at your left hand in your glory. You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or my left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared." When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. So there's a lot going on in there. We talked last week that when Jesus talked about this, it's a mindset change. We have to think differently. We're going to see in a moment exactly how Jesus responds, but we see what James and John want. They're looking for glory for themselves. And they start by coming up to Jesus and say, "We want you to do whatever we ask, but we're not going to tell you what we're going to ask you. I have kids. This is a red flag. This is not good. That no good comes from, hey, can you give me whatever I want, but I'm not going to tell you first? Not good. Red flags all over." And then they say, "We want to sit in the best seats in heaven. We want the best seats in the house. We want to sit at a Warriors game courtside. We want to sit at a Niners game on the 50-yard line. We want to sit at a Sharks game center ice. None of these things are possible right now in California." And what they asked for Jesus, the best seats in heaven, the seats of honor, the seats of glory, was not possible either. They're asking for the best. And I love this line at the end here. It says, when the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. When the other 10 disciples heard what James and John did, that they snuck behind their backs and you guys went and you asked Jesus for the best seats in heaven, like, how dare you? What did he say? Did you guys get it? Is that something we could ask? I didn't know that we could ask that. They went and they tried to get themselves these places of honor and glory. And here is how Jesus responds. Verse 42 to 45. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must become your servant." Or whoever wants to become great among you, yeah, must be your servant. "And whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus says, you look at the rulers in your life, the people in authority, and how they lord it over people. They take advantage of it. He said, that's not supposed to be the way with you. That's not how it's supposed to be. Instead, if you want to be great, and James and John were seeking a place of greatness, he said, if you want to be great, what you do actually is you look to see how can you serve. If you want to be great, you don't look for positions of power. You don't look for the seats of authority. You look for how can you serve. And that is how you find greatness. You let that sink in, because that is not how we think of greatness. When we think of greatness, we think of someone who excels at something. We think of the people who are served, not those who serve. And Jesus flips this on its head like he does with so many things. He says, if you want to be great, you need to be servant of all. And he flips everything on its head. And then Mark 10:45, which is a great verse to memorize, he says, for the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, which is incredible. That Jesus would do this. You think about, he kind of describes here then two mindsets. The first mindset is a mindset of a person who would exercise their authority over people and take advantage of it and seek the greatness for themselves. And Jesus says, that person is not great. He says, the mindset that you must have to be great, the mindset you must have is to be a servant. And that's the mindset of a follower of Jesus, is looking for the ways to serve, not for the ways to be served. It's a mindset change. We stop thinking, we have to change our attitude from what can I get to what can I give. Not to how can I be served, but how can I serve. And it's a mindset change. Philippians 2 explains what this looks like modeled in the life of Jesus. Philippians 2 verses 5 to 11. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place. And he gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. See, it's so amazing that Jesus would do this, because if there's ever anyone who shouldn't do this, it's Jesus. Jesus is the Son of God. He is God come down in human flesh. This time of year, we talk about Emmanuel. At Christmas time, we talk Emmanuel. That means God with us, that God would come from heaven to live here close to his people. And when God does that, we should serve him. And he comes to say, I came to serve, not to be served. See, that's amazing that Jesus, of anyone, gives us this model. The one person who should say, you guys need to serve me, and he would be right. Yet he says, I come to give you this model of what it means to be a servant. And so we see Jesus taking the posture of a servant. And we see greatness born in a manger. We see greatness born in this lowly little town called Bethlehem. And Jesus models that out of this little town of Bethlehem that was nothing, out of a manger, out of God coming down, Emmanuel with us, to be with us in human flesh, we see this posture of a servant. And we get maybe the most famous example that we can remember of Jesus serving, and that is in John 13. We see Jesus washes the disciples' feet. Starting in verse 1, it says, it was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave the world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, you do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Then Lord, Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. Jesus answered, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you. For he knew who was going to betray him. And that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. See, Jesus washed their feet, but that wasn't Jesus' job. Customarily in this time, when you arrived in someone's home, there would be someone who would provide some water so that your feet could be clean. And there might be a servant who does this, but it wouldn't just be any servant. This was a disgusting job, because it's as gross as you might think feet are today, think about how much worse it was back then. Because when you walk around all day with your shoes and socks on, you are ahead of the game from where they were 2,000 years ago. You walk on pavement, you drive places. Back then, they walked in sandals, they walked on dirt. And if they rode any place, they rode on an animal that probably didn't smell great. Their feet were not clean. Their feet were filthy. And so when they came into a house and it was time to clean their feet were pretty gross. And so there's no servant there. And keep in mind who Jesus is hanging out with. He's hanging out with the people who are just arguing about who gets the best space in heaven. None of them are fighting to wash each other's feet here. And so Jesus, he puts this towel around his waist, which is a sign of humbling himself in that culture. And he humbles himself as the Son of God and gets down and he washes their feet in this act of humility to show us what it is to be a servant. Jesus puts his word into action. And there's this incredible thing too, because he goes around and he washes their feet. So he washes Peter's feet, and there's some argument about that, but he washes all their other feet. and he gets to Judas. And I think most of us, if we were in Jesus' shoes, would look at Judas and say, not you. There's no way I'm washing your feet. Because Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him and that Jesus would soon be hanging on a cross. And I think most of us would look at him and be like, no way. And Jesus washes his feet, which is incredible because I think so many of us, we do not want to serve our enemy. We think there's no way I'd wash his feet. But here's the deal. We think, okay, Jesus died on the cross because Judas betrayed him. But the truth is that Jesus died on the cross for every single person that was in that room and he washed their feet. Jesus died on the cross because Peter sinned. Jesus died on the cross because you sinned. Jesus died on the cross because I sinned. Jesus didn't die on the cross because of Judas. Jesus willingly gave his life to die on the cross for us. And so Jesus washed the feet of everyone who betrayed him. We all have betrayed him. And so Jesus washes the feet of even his enemies. And for some of us, it's so easy to serve our spouse, to serve our kids, to serve your friends that you love. It's really hard to humble yourself and to serve the person that you don't like. That is way harder. And Jesus gives us the model of not just serving those that we love, but serving our enemies. And so we are given this example of Jesus who says, I will even wash the feet of Judas. And so we get that incredible example. And when he does that, what he does is he makes us realize how short we fall of his standard. When we think, hey, I'm a person who serves pretty well. I'm a person who does stuff for people. And then we see how Jesus does it. We realize I fall so short. If you're a musician, you've probably had a moment where you've had this happen. I play guitar. That's maybe even a stretch. Like that's very generous. But I play guitar, and there's times when I would watch another guitarist play. And Michael, you can't relate to this because you're much better at keyboards than I am. But when you watch another musician play, and they are so amazing at it, and you just realize, like, oh, I should just quit. Like no, like I thought I was good, and then I watched someone else play guitar and I realized, like, nope, I should just stop because they are so good. And I realized how short I fall of it. And maybe you've had that experience with something else in your life. When we look at Jesus and the model he gives for service, we realize how short we fall. The standard that Jesus calls us to. And he ends by saying this. At the end of John 13, the story where he washes the feet, he said, now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them. It goes back to the idea that we looked at last week where Jesus says, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Jesus says, now that you know you are called to serve one another, you will be blessed if you do this. Again, it turns it on its head because we think if I get served, I'm the one who's blessed. And Jesus says, if you go and serve people, then you'll be blessed. He turns it on its head, just like he does with so many other things. Jesus says, if you go and serve, you will be blessed. So we've been talking about this Christmas season really should be such a bummer because it's not going to look the way that any of us want it to. But Jesus says it is more blessed to give than to receive. So let's focus on giving to others. Let's focus on serving others, and then it will be the most blessed Christmas season. So let's approach it in that light. Let's find people in our lives that we can go serve, that we can give to. Our time, our resources, our spiritual gifts, our knowledge, our finances. Find ways to give and experience what Jesus says when he says it's more blessed to give than to receive. It's not easy. Jesus gives us this very vivid graphic model of it, of getting down and dirty. Service is sometimes dirty. Jesus washed the disciples' feet. That was dirty. Service isn't always fun. I would imagine, and put this into perspective. So Jesus washes the disciples' feet on one of the last nights he has on earth because he gets arrested, betrayed, dies on the cross very quickly after this. He spends one of his last nights washing the disciples' feet. If you knew you only had a few activities left on this earth, is that what you would choose? Because that's what Jesus did. Jesus chose to serve because Jesus came not to be served, but to serve. It's a mindset change. And so we have to realize sometimes service isn't fun. Sometimes it's dirty. Jesus shows that that service is close-knit with people, that he got close to people. Now, okay, in the COVID world, maybe don't go wash somebody's feet right now, but now it means being proximate to people, that you have a relationship with people, that you get to know them and know what their needs are. Jesus knew what the need was, and he met that need. And Jesus didn't say, this is beneath me to wash people's feet. I'm the Son of God, but this is beneath me. That wasn't his attitude. His attitude is, I can serve. So let's look for ways that we can be like Jesus and to serve. And so this Christmas season, let's look for those ways that we can experience a more blessed Christmas season as we look for ways to give, as we look for ways to serve. Let's follow the model of Jesus. So let's pray. Lord, I come to you and I know that I fall short of this. When we look at the model that Jesus gives, I don't know if any of us can say that we live up to the standard that you are calling us to. We fall short. So will you help us develop a mindset and a heart of servants, that we would seek not to be served, but to serve, that we would look at the model that Jesus gave us and live that out. Lord, will you help us to do that? We fall short of the standard, but through your grace, through the power of the Holy Spirit, will you use us, especially during this Christmas season when people need it so much, to find ways to serve the people around us that might look a little bit more creative during this season than in other seasons when there's so much that we are limited to right now because of COVID. But will you help us to find ways to serve one another, to love one another in the same way that Jesus taught us? Lord, help us to have the same attitude that Jesus has. Lord, help us to be servants and help people to take notice and see Jesus through us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We've come to this part in our service where we want to observe communion together. We want to give you a minute at home to maybe get a piece of bread or a cracker, some juice, and then we want to do this in remembrance of what the Lord Jesus has done for us and as an act of worship, and also remembering that we're part of a fellowship. We're part of a body, a local body here in San Jose, and the oneness that we have in Christ. And that was so important to Jesus on the eve of the night when he was being arrested. He was praying to the Father that we as his church would be one. And remember, in the Christmas story, it was the angels that were saying to the shepherds who were of low status in that culture that, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. He is our Savior who willingly came from heaven and allowed his body to be broken for us, his blood to be shed for the forgiveness of sins. So if you have that cracker, piece of bread, let's do this. We're reminded to do this, Jesus said, in remembrance of me. This is my body, which is broken for you. Let's do that together. Jesus also said that the cup represented his shed blood for us. If you have that, let's drink this in remembrance of his sacrifice for us. Spend just a moment in worship and praying and thanking God together. Okay.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of Memories. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath, I'll bring you more, I'll bring you more than a song. Song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper, you search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back, I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you. I'm coming back, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you, it's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you, it's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Say it's all. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Hark the herald angels sing glory to the newborn King. On earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations, rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by higher
tears have not dulled. Christ the everlasting Lord, made in time, behold him come, offspring of the Virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh that God had seen, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the hand-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, ends with healing in his wings. While he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Just want to end our service as we are experiencing all these cases increasing. Just pray for the virus, not for the virus, but for us because of the virus, and for healthcare workers and first responders, all that. So let's end our service praying. Lord, we pray that you would bring an end to this virus, that you would keep us safe, that you would especially be with healthcare workers, whatever form that they take. We thank you for their service. We thank you for what you are doing through them and their sacrifice. Pray that you would keep them safe. Be with everyone that has to be out there working with the public. And we pray that you would bring an end to this. Lord, we can't wait for the day when we can gather back together in person again and celebrate you together. And in the meantime, we're so grateful for this technology that allows us to do that digitally. So we praise you. We thank you. Please lay people on our hearts that we can serve and show the overwhelming love of Jesus to. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week.